Star Trek the Animated Series is the red-shirted stepchild of the Star Trek fandom. Along with comics, novelizations, video games, like half of the... Okay, there's a lot of red-shirted stepchildren in the Star Trek fandom, but Star Trek the Animated Series kind of takes the cake. Not only is it not remembered by a lot of fandom, forgotten to the past of an analog Saturday morning, back in the good old days, Wonder Years sort of effect, but also, a lot of the fandom simply does not know that Star Trek the Animated Series exists. I stumbled upon it on Netflix several years ago and started watching it. And yes, the animation is terrible. It's in a half-hour format instead of an hour-long format. Stories are a bit strange. It was bid as a Saturday morning cartoon, but we'll get into all of this. My name is Steve, and this is Highly Illogical, a Dying of Exposure series. This series is going to dive in, episode by episode, on each of Star Trek the Animated Series' 22 episodes spread across two seasons, though it really feels more like one. We're not only going to analyze what happens in each episode, where I will synopsize the plot for you, discuss the overall quality in it as it compares to Star Trek the original series, but we will also be discussing the background of it. Who was writing? Who was directing? How this series came to be? How it was received? And maybe a little bit about why it seemed to disappear off the map and how it was forgotten by the original and the next generation of Star Trek fans. Now, for a little background on Star Trek the Animated Series. Star Trek the Animated Series was released in 1973 by Paramount Productions under the behest of Gene Roddenberry. Due to the popular syndication of the original series, which, while struggling in its original airing, was gaining in reruns and syndicated television time slots, Star Trek the Animated Series seemed like a logical step. More controlled budgets, less actors, less sets, something that could gain in popularity. In the 70s, we saw a large boom in the original major boom of the Saturday morning cartoon, and they were hungry for any kind of property that could already grab interest. Filmation was contracted with Paramount Productions to release 22 episodes of the animated series, with Gene Roddenberry having the vision that this was the continuing stories of the five-year mission of the original Star Trek. Filmation, you of course remember, released such hot hits as the Fantastic Voyage animated series, The Archie Show, The Hardy Boys, The Brady Kids adaptation, and several more since the animated series, such as Shazam and The Ghostbusters. No, not the good Ghostbusters, the live-action Ghostbusters based off the bad Ghostbusters. Eventually gathering up the majority of the original cast, they went into production for $75,000 an episode. Now, even in the 70s, that's a pretty tight budget for an animated series, and it's definitely going to show throughout this series and through the stills and clips of animation I will be showing you. But with both the combination of the original cast, several of the original producers and writers, and Gene Roddenberry at the helm, this looked to be an interesting take on the Star Trek universe. The major changes to consider in this Star Trek versus, say, the original series is number one, animated, of course, number two, half-hour episodes instead of full hour-long episodes, and number three, and most importantly, Gene Roddenberry, while airing this on Saturday mornings for children ostensibly, did not want to lose that Star Trek feel and wanted to make sure that this series felt like the original Star Trek. Well, if you expected this animated series to be a simplification made for juveniles of the original Star Trek, you will be mildly surprised at how adult and consistent it is with the original series. Star Trek the original series was always an all-ages show, and there was no reason the Saturday morning cartoon couldn't do the same thing. Now let's get into the premiere episode of Star Trek the animated series, Beyond the Farthest Star. This episode was directed by Hal Sutherland. Now, he was one of the founders of Filmation, but a bigger deal was that in being a founder of Filmation, he worked on properties like Superman, Batman, adaptations of Sabrina, The New Adventures of Flash Gordon, certainly a big deal and definitely a strong influencer in Filmation's journey from the late 60s through the 70s. He even caught directing one episode of He-Man and the Masters of the Universe later in the 80s. Beyond the Farthest Star is written by Samuel L. Peoples. Now that's important, not only because Samuel L. Peoples is a pretty badass person, writing Western novels, writing television scripts for various Western television shows, being friends with Gene Roddenberry and talking to him about Star Trek. The reason he should be noticeable to Star Trek fans is he wrote Where No Man Has Gone Before, which was the second pilot and the thing that made Star Trek the original series actually producible. So his early discussions with Gene Roddenberry in the development of the series and his ability to write that script made him the most logical choice to come back and write the pilot episode for the animated series. Let's get into the plot. Star Trek the Animated Series Beyond the Farthest Star picks up right where the series left off after being canceled in 1969. The crew of the Enterprise is out there exploring the furthest reaches of space, searching for the unknown. In the outermost rim of the galaxy, the Enterprise is dragged into orbit of a dead star. This alone presented danger, but quickly they're distracted by a 300 million year old alien pod ship. Now, what's impressive about that is that this kid's cartoon immediately begins addressing what 300 million years ago must have been like, before life had even began on Earth. So there's almost no power coming from this ship, but they can't help but explore it. This ship seems to be trapped in the same orbit due to the gravity of the dead star. Plus, of course, it's the crew of the Enterprise's job to investigate and explore the unknown. Upon beaming aboard, they discover there is a small, subtle life signature on this vastly alien ship. And while they explore rooms wearing their life support belts, they discover that this must have been some sort of insectoid hive race, alien race. And they become more and more curious about this slowly growing energy source that they did not originally scan before beaming over to the alien spaceship. Eventually, they land upon a recorded message from the previous captain of the spaceship, who is indeed an insectoid alien, in a level of difference from humanity that could have never passed the costuming budget on the live-action original series. This recorded message expresses an immediate danger to them. There's a life form that they discovered once they were trapped by the dead star that was also trapped there, that was feeding on the energy of the alien space pod ship and trying to convince them, threaten them, blackmail them to take them away from the dead star where it could go and continue to feed energy and amass more of itself and slowly fill up the galaxy. Obviously, with that much danger, the crew of the Enterprise seeks to beam back immediately, but unfortunately, this amorphous electromagnetic field gaseous alien manages to hitch a ride on the transporter signal and gets itself onto the Enterprise. This alien magnetic field being quickly infects the ship's computers, disables the self-destruct mechanism, thus foiling the inevitable self-sacrifice plan that Spock develops, and begins threatening the crew to obey it and allow it to exit the gravity pool of the star and take it toward what we find out is the center of the galaxy. The crew of the Enterprise manage to use their time together, their ability to communicate and trust each other's instincts, and some covert discussions and manipulations to convince the creature that they need to manually set navigation from the bridge. This becomes a game of chicken where Kirk drives the Enterprise directly at the dead star, threatening that he will kill them all if the alien does not abandon ship. The alien, of course, tries to overpower Kirk with some sort of security laser that appears to be installed on the bridge of the Enterprise for the purposes of this animated series, or maybe just this scene. And Kirk, through his fortitude of will, takes the struggle and immense pain and keeps pushing. Eventually, the creature abandons the Enterprise, and the crew uses that increased gravity to swing themselves out of orbit of the dead star and escape the magnetic creature that was malevolent in its desire to expand. What's interesting about this episode is that it held to the consistent themes of Star Trek the original series. Yes, the creature they were dealing with was dangerous. Yes, it would have expanded itself across all life, taking control of all electronic and living things, probably executed life in the billions. However, it was also lonely. It had been down there at least 300 million years plus some, and perhaps its natural course of expansion was simply a way to fill the loneliness. In fact, when they're escaping, you can hear it speak so alone. What creature with 300 million years of isolation would not become mad and aggressive and desperate to escape at the cost of whatever lives it has to destroy? The crew of the Enterprise all behave consistently to the tones of their characters. Kirk uses his own gumption and stubbornness and will to survive to solve the problem. Spock offers up a logical solution, but involves self-sacrifice that Kirk simply cannot accept. Bones is pensive and comments on the whole ordeal and acts as the worry and nerves and consciousness of the crew. Scotty is a capable engineer who does what he can, but unfortunately, like so many episodes of Star Trek, his hands are tied. The episode wasn't about being trapped by the dead star. It wasn't about finding a 300 million year old insectoid spaceship of possibly dangerous aliens. It was about the fact that over 300 million years between two alien races, both vastly different in where they came from, recognize the danger of this being and recognize that they may need to sacrifice themselves to prevent this being from infecting the entire galaxy. It's meaningful. It's Star Trek, moral conversations, real dangers, not just to the crew or threatening the lives of the Enterprise as a whole or maybe a planet, but the lives of an entire spacefaring civilization. The episode cuts like a Star Trek episode, other than one wacky clang sound effect when Scotty is pinned down by some mechanical hardware on the alien space pod. The sound effects felt like Star Trek. Even though the score was redone down to the theme song, that was a deliberate choice and not a requirement of the show, and it still felt consistent with the original series. Everything feels like a Star Trek the original series episode. Now, here's where the bad comes in. Unfortunately, Star Trek, the original series, and Next Gen, and every Star Trek since, loves a good close-up reaction shot, which can come across with good actors like DeForest Kelly, who manages to act everything through the eyes of Bones. But when it cuts to a still-framed animation, or perhaps a three-frame animation of eyes looking left to right, and then back to a Kirk, who is a still-framed animation, over to a Spock, who has an eyebrow raised of a three-frame animation, and then back to Kirk again, with no life in the eyes because of these cartoons, and especially little movement because of the low budgets. This does not work. It doesn't create the tension that they would have had with the live actors. Sure, the animation allows for a lot more set design, stranger aliens, and better effects within the containment of the animation. However, you can't help but constantly notice the budget-cutting measures, the covering faces with hands so that they don't need to animate the mouths, the minimal movements, and actual frame-to-frame animation in order to keep the show within the $75,000 per episode requirement. Having the voice cast all there, minus Walter Koenig as Chekhov, definitely helped carry this. So what you have to do is you have to look past that low-budget animation. You have to look past the fact that they need to wrap something up in 22 minutes instead of 42 minutes. You have to look past what you think is just a hokey cash-in like a Gilligan in Space and is instead a continuation of some of the very best of Star Trek. Some end-bit trivia. James Doohan, the actor that plays Scotty, actually did the voice of the magnetic field alien. Number one, you cannot tell that it is James Doohan. Number two, I do detect a hint of Dalek in the delivery. And that's what makes Star Trek the Animated Series even more interesting. where the original Star Trek was still coming out in the introductory decade of science fiction on television, Star Trek the Animated Series had a few more years to breathe with it. Will there be other influences, other pieces of other science fiction that clearly show in the animated series episodes? We're going to find out. That'll wrap up this first episode of Highly Illogical, Dying of Exposure series. My name is Steve. Remember, hit like and subscribe for all your updated Star Trek content to the Dying of Exposure YouTube channel. Follow us on social media at Dying of Exposure. If you're interested in more Star Trek content, I will be posting up quick responses to each new episode of Star Trek Picard, which I'm very excited for, and Season 3 Star Trek Discovery when it happens after that. Here at Dying of Exposure, we love our Trek. We hope you do too. Live long and prosper.